So Marc Blitzstein, as I said, wrote Cradle Will Rock, which has a famous and vaunted history, including the fact that there was a movie made about it, which is actually great. I recommend you all see it. He continued to do, that was maybe certainly his most successful and famous piece. It works very well because it's a kind of a cartoon. It's set in a town called Steel Town, and practically all of Steel Town is owned by Mr. Mister. And Mr. Mister's wife is called Mrs. Mister, and his son is called Junior Mister, and his daughter is called Sister Mister. And there is a man organizing the union in the Steel Town steel industry, whose name is Larry Foreman. There's a druggist. The selections we'll be doing involve Mrs. Mister visiting Reverend Salvation, and also Mr. Mister and Editor Daly. The first idea for Cradle Will Rock apparently came from Hans Eisler. Blitzstein had written a song which was supposed to be a song of Streetwalker, and he was playing at a party that Eisler was at, and Eisler said, well, it would be really interesting to show how actually everybody's a prostitute. So in fact, in this show, everybody's a prostitute, as you'll see from Reverend Salvation. Blitzstein continued to do pieces that had various kinds of political overtones. Juno, which is based on a play by Sean O'Casey called Juno and the Paycock, is set in the Irish Revolution. Regina is an opera which is based on The Little Foxes by Lillian Hellman, which is more or less about greedy, dirty capitalists in Alabama. Let's see, what else are we doing? the other thing we're doing, Blitzstein was also in the Air Force, in the Information Service in the Second World War, and he was commissioned to do a piece called the Airborne Symphony, and Emily is from the Airborne Symphony. I think that's absolutely everything you could possibly want to know.
Thank you. Before the opening of a door to the The purest kind of a guy. Ever hear how I first met that purest kind of a guy? I'll sing you how it was. The rain was rain and rain. The snow was snow and snow. It was a stormy night to catch a freight on the Biango. I pulled my cap down low. I pulled my coat up tight. I run with all my might to hop a freight on a stormy night. I make it? No, I can't. The cops are right behind. The cars go rushing past. I run along the side. A streak of light I see. A door slides open wide. Someone holds out his hand to me. Can you guess? Yeah, it's Joe. Hooray for Joe. That's the kind of man, right away, says I, to myself, that man's the purest kind of a guy. Then I barely spoke, thank you, Joe, says I, and he made some little joke, the purest kind of a guy. Now maybe you're just the life of the party. I'll take the man I don't have to doubt. A man who does what the others spout. I had my back to the wall, didn't know what it was all about. And when I next look around, I'll be bound, didn't Joe get me out? When that kind of man gives the gals the eye, they kinda trip and run to meet the purest kind of a guy. Oh, the purest kind of a guy is the dearest kind, the sincerest kind of a guy. Our little pride and joy, our little baby boy, he's kinda looking up, he's kinda big on me, oh my. He's got a birthday, it is his birthday, it is the best day for the purest kind of a guy. Take it from me, who knows, and don't make no mistake. Whenever there are Joes, the world is on the make. And so tonight is why we give a hello to the purest kind of a guy.
I did forget one thing. So the Blitzstein got a commission from the Ford Foundation to write an opera for the Met, and he decided that he would write it about Sacco and Vanzetti. as soon as it was announced, there was an incredible uproar about how this was politicized and radical and everything. It turned out that Rudolph Bing didn't know who Sacco and Vanzetti were. He thought they were Italian singers or something. So, in fact, he didn't finish the opera. He was working on it, went on vacation in Martinique, and picked up three French sailors who beat him to death. So this is a surviving aria.
With a woman to be, with a woman to be, with a woman to be. With a woman to be, and never more be sad and lonely. On a Sunday day, can't dress the finest way, go ring her bell, and she put on her hat. With a woman to be, with a woman.
In the fine art of panhandling. I goes up to this rich woman, and right in front of her, I collapses. She says, "Are you one of the people who work here?" I says, "I don't exactly work here. They let me come and rest myself sometimes." She says, "What's the matter? Are you ill?" I says, "Well, ill, well, my life." She says, "What's the matter with your life?" So I tells her. Ah, madam, welcome, I will spare you my tale of woe. You'd sorrow so your heart would break. That was my darling mother who coiced and drank. One day she sank down in that lake. The lake by her window, and she in bed by liquor maimed. She must have fell out and fell in. She's dead and still unclaimed. For 10 years, we haven't found the body. Madam, I won't tell you about myself. I'm on the shelf, a ruined life. My children in the gutter and garbage grew. Their mother too, my wedded wife. And me with lumbago and bitten by a special coice. All night and all day I'll be sitting by and feeling worse and worse. Why? I got a secret passion. This old wreck can still dream, madam. You'd never guess. She says, liquor too, I suppose? Me? Never touched it. Riches? Nah, I don't crave riches. She says, women? Really, madam, you've mistaken your man. You'll only laugh at me. You think it's childish. What is it? Go on! You sure? Oh, lead me to that smell of penny candy. Although I ain't got any penny handy. If you will only say that I may smell a spearmint bell, a nonpareil, a scotch delight, a taffy bite. No, not a bite, but just a smell. Take me away, I don't feel well. Oh, I go crazy only smelling when I cannot buy a thing today. She says, what a peculiar passion you have. But me, I'm an artist. I goes right on, I says, I guess that penny candy has always been my setting sin and secret vice. And though it is my shame, I can think of tons of other ones not near so nice. I once had an uncle was just like me, a queer galoot. He fell off a derrick and broke his knee. They had to shoot. But when they began to chloroform him, he said, take it away! No chloroform! So they said, well, what do we give him? So he said, oh, lead me to that smell of penny candy. That's all I need to make me fine and dandy. If you will only say that I may smell them Tootsie Rolls, them licorice mops, them jelly beans, them chocolate drops. For if I cannot have one smell, it's just as well I pass away today. She says, you mean to say you really dream of penny candy? You know, I think that's touching, touching. Aha, and now I presses to the advantage. And madam, would you guess that my every kid inherited my love for sweets? The misery is that I can never try to satisfy the little treats. For many and many's the number of pennies could be spent. Did you know the price of an orange slice? It's 6 for a cent. Go on, kids. Back to your gutter. She says, well, how many children do you have? Four. Big one. Medium. Little one.
is. The most pitiful story I ever heard. Here, take this, my poor, poor man. She hands me a bill. It was 20 smackers. I could have bought out a store of penny candy. But me, I'm an artist. I runs after her and says, here, lady, take back your money. I'll never forget you. For to me, madam, to me, you're an all-day sucker.
It was Tuesday, last week. Yeah, Tuesday. I had breakfast at Andy's, coffee and. For lunch, I had coffee and again. For dinner, I could only afford coffee. Then I looked on the floor, and I see a nickel shine in there. Gee, Andy, coffee and! And then I looked closer. That was no nickel. Not coffee and Andy, just coffee, Andy. Cute, huh? Mister, you don't know what it felt like. Thinking that was a nickel under my foot.
Nickel under.
for no good reason, just gypped. From the start until the finish comes, they feed him out of garbage cans, they greet him in the slums. Joe Worker will go to shops where stuff is on show. He'll look at the meat, he'll look at the bread, and too little to eat sorta goes to the head. One big question inside me cries, how many fakers, peace undertakers, paid strike breakers, how many toiling, ailing, dying, piled up bodies, brother, does it take to make
I'll break you. Oh, the press, the press, the freedom of the press. The never take away the freedom of the press. That falling series now.
Yes, mister, mister, yes.
With a hey little key and a hey money low.
No?
Yes, sir, yes, yes.
For whichever side will pay the best.
So they got old man Salvation in the night court at last. Do you know what the charge ought to be? Habitual prostitution since 1915.
My dear Mrs. Mister.
Reverend Salvation, how are you? It's been weeks I wanted to meet you and to greet you. I'm a stranger too. And I brought along our monthly present. But one thing's not so pleasant, Father dear. I fear that things cannot continue forever. Hard times, I can assure you, hard times. For us, for you, hard times. Father, what can we do? The market hasn't been ideal. We have to sell our steel to French or English or German. Mention that you do declare the chairman sign of the war.
righteousness conquers, iniquity perishes, peace is a wonderful thing. But when I say peace, I'm referring to inner peace. Let there be no misconception. The peace you remember, which passeth beyond understanding. We must remember our honor and the valor and pride which is ours to cherish and use. Knowing well that peace without honor no good American should excuse. Surely I need not remind you of the war which is simply dreadful for everyone. There we take no side, still we know who defends sweet peace from the savage on.
Amen.
Collection!
But in 1917...
Peace we're for, this is war.